So hello to everyone who decided to join this event, the CanWISP 2021. And my name is Tomasz Wolenski, and I will walk you through the product introduction to RF elements antennas and other products as well. Our product range covers antennas, integration platforms, and brackets. But today I will speak mainly about the antennas and a little bit about the integration platforms at the end. So the product map you see shows our antennas organized according to the beam shape, connector interface, and gain. The beam shape is changing in the vertical direction. So the symmetrical antennas are in the top two lines, and the asymmetrical ones below in the third line. In the horizontal direction, the gain is increasing from left to right. But before we go to the antennas themselves, I will speak about the twist port and twist port adapters, which are displayed on the bottom line, and now you can see them zoomed in, to help you understand the advantages of the twist port compared to the traditional coaxial connector interface. Twist port is RF Element's proprietary waveguide connector for connecting radio with antennas. And WISP has two essential advantages. So first, because it is a waveguide connector, WISP introduces practically zero loss into the system. Now this is very important to achieve excellent RF performance and to reach the furthest customers you possibly can. And second, WISP combines the radio mounting and RF connection into a single and easy to use interface. It is extremely easy and safe to operate. Twist port is not only a RF connector between the radio and the antenna, but also mounts the radio on the antenna at the same time. So when you insert and twist the radio, it locks in automatically and stays mounted. And unlocking is equally easy. Just twisting the outer locking ring, the radio is released and you can reverse the movement of installation. In our reference radio design, back in 2014, we removed the pigtails and integrated the twist port male connector directly into the circuit board of a radio. And this radio, the radio can be attached to any twist port antenna while introducing practically zero loss. And this is why we consider twist port being a truly revolutionary interface, introducing a whole new ecosystem built on the advantages of the waveguide and excellent mechanical design. And all this together enables easy connection with virtually zero loss RF performance. The twist port adapter solves a simple task of converting the coaxial radio interface of third-party radios into the twist port male interface. And the adapter enables intuitive connection of both the radio and the antenna, actually. The twist port adapters are easy to use and have very low loss. Now you can see on the animation what is inside of a typical twist port adapter. So the coaxial cables are connecting the waveguide to the radio connectors. And these are high quality cables with semi-rigid shielding. And the cables are integrated in the adapter body. And because of this, you do not need to bend, connect or disconnect and constantly handle these cables over and over, which results into very stable and lasting performance. Now, the rest of the adapter is designed to accommodate most popular radios used in WISP industry. Since most of the radios have different body shape, we have a number of twist port adapters to fit them naturally. And all the adapters I will show you on the following slides are compatible with every twist port antenna. So you do not need to worry that you will need a separate twist port adapter for each antenna. No, every twist port adapter fits any twist port antenna. And twist port adapters have three types of connection on the side of the radio. So first, the most common radio interface is a pair of SMA connectors. So the radios with coaxial output are connected to the corresponding adapter by sliding the radio in until it clicks and locks the radio in place. Second, few radios in the WISP industry have a waveguide output. And assembling a few parts together converts the third-party waveguide output to the twist port male connector. And thirdly, finally, many microtech radios come as bare PCBs without any enclosure whatsoever, in which case you need to insert the whole PCB into our adapter to make it work, as you can see from the animation. It is important to emphasize that twist port adapters work with any twist port antenna. And the adapters are specific on the side of the radio, simply because of different shapes of those third-party radios. But on the side of the antenna, there's always the same twist port connector, which is compatible with any twist port antenna. So once you have the right adapter for your radio, you're all set and you can connect it with any twist port antenna. We have twist port adapters for all the four major radio brands in WISP industry. So Cambium, Mimosa, Ubiquiti, and Microtik, and all of them are very easy and reliable radio installation and removal. For Cambium, we have two adapters, TPA EPMP in the top row and the TPA Adapt E2K on the bottom. So the TPA EPMP is compatible with EPMP 1000, both the client and the AP version. But also this adapter is compatible with the newest radios from Cambium, so the EPMP 3000L AP, as well as the client version of this radio. The TPA adapter on the bottom, the E2K, works with the EPMP 2000, as well as the new Force 400C. Yeah, the EPMP Force 400C, the recently released 802.11ax radio from Cambium. For Ubiquiti, we have four adapters. So the TPA path, the first one on the top left, is compatible with the Rocket Prism 5AC and the 5AC Gen 2, so both generations, and both generations of the air fiber, so meaning air fiber 5X and 5X HD, as well as the LTU Rocket. So this one adapter is compatible with five different radios. So the twist port adapter for IsoStation is in the lower left side, is compatible with the IsoStation M5, Prism Station, and IsoStation 5AC, which are the waveguide radios from Ubiquiti. And the older Rocket M5 works with the TPA RM5, and the Rocket 5AC Lite works with the TPA R5AC. For Mimosa radios, we have the twist port adapter, the TPA C5C, compatible with the C5C radio. The C5X, a waveguide-based Mimosa radio, works with the TPA C5X. And for the newest A5X radio, we have the TPA A5X. For those who are using the Microtik radios, we have the twist port adapter TPA RBP with the fully plastic body. Yeah, so this adapter is fully plastic, and the TPA RBC in the top row has a full metal body. It's the twist port adapter that offers protection of the radio from the changing weather and noise somewhat better than the plastic counterpart. But both of them are compatible with the router board 4, 7, and 9 series of the Microtik radios, as well as the M11. Finally, for those who prefer using twist port antennas, with the third-party radios, for which we do not have a matching custom-made adapter, we have the connectorized twist port adapter, which is available or is equipped with the two SMA connectors to which you can connect anything you like with the cable. Since this is a lot of information to remember, so which twist port adapter fits with what radio, we prepared a little cheat sheet for you, for your quick reference. So you can download this cheat sheet as a printable PDF from our webpage in the download section when you slide all the way down to on our homepage. So horn sector antennas are by far the most effective technology to deal with the RF noise. So let's look at a detailed explanation how. While the traditional sector antennas radiate pretty much into every direction, which you can see on the right side of the of this slide, the horn radiates only in the direction of the main lobe. Yeah, so this is the essential advantage of horns, their zero side lobes radiation pattern. Now, since side lobes collect and transmit the noise, getting rid of the side lobes equals getting rid of the noise. But simply saying an antenna has zero side lobes is somewhat vague. So it's like saying, well, I drove very fast, instead of saying I drove 200 kilometers per hour, when it's clear to everyone how fast you actually drove. So is there a measure of the amount of side lobes an antenna has? Yes, there is. It's beam efficiency. So it is the ratio of the energy contained in the main lobe to the total energy an antenna radiates. In other words, it says what part of the radiated energy is going into the main lobe. So the higher the beam efficiency is, the less side lobes an antenna has. The maximum beam efficiency is 100%, which is the best case. The closer to 0% the beam efficiency is, the more side lobes an antenna has. Beam efficiency makes comparison of two antennas in terms of the side lobe performance extremely easy. The higher number wins. That's it. And in this example, you can see the symmetrical horn has beam efficiency of 94%. So only 6% of the power it radiates is in the side lobes. A typical patch array sector, on the other hand, has a beam efficiency of 69%. So the remaining 31% of the energy it radiates is in the side lobes. So 94% is clearly more than 69. And therefore, symmetrical horn is much better antenna in terms of noise suppression. And the rest of our horn sectors are no worse whatsoever. In fact, the average beam efficiency across all our antennas is 93%. So the ultra horn, for example, has beam efficiency of 99%, which makes it the best antenna in terms of the noise suppression on the WISP market, in our opinion. Collocating increasing amount of patch array sectors is problematic. You see a gradual decline of the network throughput and stability until you arrive at a point where an additional sector, even one more additional sector, kills the site completely. Now, with horns, this problem is practically non-existent. The zero side lobe pattern enables predictable dense collocations without any degradation of the network performance. Since they don't have any side lobes, they don't collect or transmit their surrounding noise. So how densely can you collocate horns? And that's the question. These images give you a clear answer: very densely. So many sectors on one side are only possible when using horns. Like, no traditional sector will let you do this kind of deployments and installs. The frequency stability of the radiation pattern of a horn is unmatched. So you can see it changing a little bit with the frequency, but the resulting change of the coverage area is negligible. The frequency stability is a factor important for connection stability when changing the channels. So with the horns, there is practically no change in the coverage throughput, of the useful spectrum, throughout the useful spectrum. Most patch array sector antennas have many side lobes, and unfortunately also the main lobe that changes with frequency. Yes, so both side lobes and the main lobe change with frequency, and this results in two fluctuating coverage of a sector, perceived throughout the sector, and especially by the customers at the edges of a sector, as unstable throughput. Yeah, not to say the added noise because of all those big and many side lobes. The maximum gain further illustrates the stability of horns. So the red gain curve is, the green gain curve is almost completely flat. Yeah, And that's the gain of the horns in general. Whereas with the traditional sector, the gain changes drastically within the same frequency band, which is completely undesirable. So ideally, the gain curve should be completely horizontal. And this is what horns practically do have already. Unlike any antenna technology on the market, the RF element horns offer a unique toolset of 11 different antennas that let you optimize the coverage you provide, regardless of the customer density or distribution. So the denser the sector is with the customers, the narrower beamwidth you want to use, and vice versa. The lower customer density areas are better covered with the wider beamwidth horns. All the favorable properties of horn technology enable unlimited scalability of 5 GHz wireless networks. Because if a sector performs reliably and with the minimum noise, and you can keep adding more and more sectors without degrading the performance of those already in place, you have won. You can plan your network coverage with the precision and with all the horns at hand. The sky is the limit on how big your network can actually be. And this is the core message of our technology, the sustainable and fast wireless. Compared to the traditional patch array sector antenna with very narrow beam in the elevation plane, horns can have symmetrical beam, for example, meaning it has the same width in the azimuth and elevation. So that's the case with the symmetrical horns. The asymmetrical horns with have the radiation pattern that combines the best of the horn technology and the patch array sectors. So on one hand, it's the shape of the main beam that is similar to the patch array sector with the narrower beam width in the elevation plane, compared to the symmetrical horn, of course. But at the same time, it has the zero side lobes, as all our horns do. With the traditional patch array sectors, it is hard to cover the areas near the site. With horns both symmetrical and asymmetrical, this problem is practically non-existent. Thanks to the extra beam width in the elevation plane the horns offer, the coverage of the areas near the tower is automatic, regardless of the landscape type. And this difference is most obvious in the mountainous areas. Here, the traditional patch arrays completely fail because of their narrow elevation beamwidth. Again, but horns do just fine. Again, thanks to the wider radiation pattern in the elevation plane. The down tilt is a huge factor influencing the coverage area when you're using the traditional patch array sectors. You can see that anything beyond a few degrees of the down tilt makes the patch arrays practically useless. You completely lose the coverage of the distant areas, and all that it takes is a few degrees of down tilt. Now with horns, the down tilt is an added functionality. The coverage area smoothly shrinks while maintaining its shape, so changing the down tilt, you can dynamically change the sector coverage as you wish, obviously depending on the situation, as well as decrease the noise level, because the bigger the down tilt, the less noise you see and receive from the distant areas. The size of your horns makes their installation easy, even on a crowded site, and saves you the tower rental fees too. So with their size being a fraction of the traditional patch array sectors, you can fit much more sectors in the same place when comparing the traditional patch array technology and our horn technology. The 30-degree asymmetrical horn has a beam switch feature. So swapping the position of the handle and the bracket, the radiation pattern rotates 90 degrees. So you switch from the 30-degree beamwidth to the 20-degree beamwidth, in case you need to, for example, narrow down the sector you cover. And beam switch basically makes this antenna really two-in-one, because just by the simple mechanical adjustment, you can switch the beamwidth this antenna offers. Our bracket is extremely sturdy and simple to use at the same time. We really minimize the number of parts needed to mount our antennas, with at the same time no compromise whatsoever to the strength of the attachment, its durability and ease of use. All you need are two bolts to mount the bracket, and after you adjust the aiming and align the antenna to the maximum signal, all you need to do is to tighten a few bolts to fix the position, and the antenna is installed. As simple as that. You know, no complicated brackets that you have to pre-assemble or make sure that you don't drop the parts that are so many in number. Now, just a few bolts, the minimum possible to maintain the quality and reliable connection with the tower. Our antennas are built to last. Now, we use high quality die-cast, stamped or extruded aluminium, stainless steel hardware, and UV-resistant plastic, so you can deploy horns in all kinds of climates and weather conditions with really the guarantee of durability. And horns give you the freedom to, you know, to use a suitable tool for any kind of situation you're in. So sometimes you, this is something that you may not be actually used to if you use mainly the traditional sectors. Now, take the example in the middle. The symmetrical horn for dense customer area, the asymmetrical horn on the bottom for less dense area, and with the customers further apart, and our patchery sector in the middle for the very low customer density base. So, wonderful use case of all three types of horns on one site. Super dense collocations and super dense sectors, you can see here, are no exception for horns and are no problem whatsoever at the same time. And all these sectors provide excellent and stable performance, something you can only achieve with horns. Or, for example, these narrow sectors with three ultra horns on the right. The cluster deployments are simply effortless with horns. So with horns, in general, you have two options for radio connectivity. Let's have a look. You can choose horns with the twist port, yeah, which we already introduced in length at the beginning. So it's our proprietary waveguide connector with practically zero loss and super easy installation and removal of the radio. Or you may prefer the female N connector interface, which is a traditional coaxial interface for cases when, for some reason, using twist port adapter is not an option for you. So the antennas are actually identical from the RF point of view. So the gain and the beamwidth are completely the same. The only difference is the connector interface. And now let's have a short look at our horn accessories. Twin horn bracket is a mounting bracket for two symmetrical horns of any beamwidth, and for both the twist port and the CC connectorized version with the N connectors. So the twin horn bracket comes with an improved mounting bracket and comfortable handle, which you can clip to a carabiner for easy hauling up the tower. And mind you, just to repeat and make it clear above all, this bracket is only meant for symmetrical horn antennas. The twin horn bracket has two default options for radio mounting. So the four-channel radio, the Cambium Networks EPMP 3000 or Mimosa A5C. And twin horn bracket makes the high-density sectors easy to aim, or enables you to leverage the 4x4 MIMO setup. You can also use twin horn bracket with two radios with the twist port adapters and use one sector as the backup, for example. The bracket gives you many options of how to use it with headache-free alignment. Yeah, and for a complete list of the compatibility of the adapters with the twin horn bracket, you should check the data sheet to the bracket on our page. And now we come to our parabolic dish antennas. The ultra dish is directional parabolic dish with optimized side lobe performance. It comes in two sizes. So the ultra dish TP400, which stands for 400 millimeters, and the ultra dish TP550 for the which has the diameter of 550 millimeters. So their gain is 24 for the smaller one and 27 for the bigger one. And the antennas are available already now, and they're sold in convenient 4-packs. The radiation pattern of ultra dish provides high gain needed for these long distance lengths with suppressed side lobes for increased noise immunity. And with dish type of antennas, completely avoiding the side lobes is actually really not possible. What is possible though, and what was performed with our dish antennas, is that we optimized the design of the antenna to suppress the side lobes, which results into improved performance when compared to competitive products. And the improved performance is possible without the need to install any additional shielding. Both of our ultra dish antennas have a very stable gain over the whole bandwidth of operation. And the difference between the horizontal and vertical chains is so small that the gain curves in the graphs are practically overlapping, which is why you see only one curve in each of the graphs. So the balanced performance of the horizontal and vertical system is important for planning of a stable and reliable link. So as you change the polarization, you see exactly the same performance. Ultra dish is suitable for areas with high surrounding noise levels. And typically those are most of the urban and suburban areas. Now the ultra dish delivers highly focused beam suppressing the surrounding noise. And cleaner radiation pattern of ultra dish also eliminates unwanted connections to multiple access points. Simply because of the lack of those side lobes, the antenna and consequently the radio doesn't see those neighboring access points. And here are some examples of the ultra dish deployments. And maybe if you check our social media channels, you can see a lot more installations or examples of these installations of ultra dish, or actually any of our antennas for that matter. Now on to our patch array sector antenna. So if you should use a patch array sector antenna, it should be AS520. So with 20 dBi gain and 100 degree beamwidth at -6 dB. And this antenna is also designed to work in the unlicensed 5 GHz band. The array sector is patch array antenna equipped with our proprietary backshield technology. And backshield is frequency selective surface, and it is integrated directly in the antenna body. It is designed to effectively suppress the back radiation, so you do not need to use any additional shields or reflectors with these antennas. Everything is included in the package. Array sector is designed to have the same radiation pattern for both polarizations to ensure perfect coverage at the sector edges. And this is a very important feature for a sector antenna, to deliver equal coverage in both horizontal and vertical system. And this graph is telling you that in the whole useful bandwidth, starting from 5.1 up to 5.9 GHz, the gain of our patch array sector is completely stable. So the top two lines are completely flat. And this is a feature truly unique and difficult to achieve with patch array antennas. The stability of the gain you see with our patch array antenna is important for reliable performance as you switch the channels. Again, switching the channel, you see absolutely no difference to the antenna performance. And the AS520 can easily be connected to many commonly used radios in the WISP industry. Now with the standard bracket, all it takes to connect the radio is to slide it in until it clicks, and the hood on the top of the radio and on top of the cable interface protects the radio and the connection from the impinging weather conditions. So let's now move on to shortly discover our integration platforms. The Station Box Alu Mini is a small form factor enclosure, which is suitable for many IoT or other wireless applications. And it is made of solid aluminium, so it protects your circuit board from the elements and RF noise very well. The files for the 3D printing of various insert boards that help you integrate the circuit boards are actually available for download on our webpage. So again, if you go to our homepage, slide all the way down and click on the download section, you'll find those 3D printing files there. The station box is very easy to install and connect to. As you see from this animation, it only takes a few minutes to attach the holder to the pole and even less to mount the station box itself onto it. Yeah, besides that, the mounting bracket is also made of aluminium, so it will last for a long time in all kinds of conditions and weather. The Station Box Alu is our bigger integration platform that accommodates larger size boards or more smaller ones. It's really up to you. The space the Station Box Alu provides gives you a lot of options. So the Station Box Alu is made of die-cast aluminium, and the paint on the surface is made of UV resistant. And with the IP55 rating, it will withstand and resist any weather conditions. So the plastic board with many options for the integration of the MikroTik, Alex, or TP-Link boards. For full compatibility list, actually, you should again check the datasheet on our webpage. Yeah, so you can mount the station box on a pole or mount it on the wall if you want. It's really up to you. The essence of this integration platform is that it really offers you a lot of options with a lot of possible outputs you can use and have at your disposal. So the RF elements, we address the problem of RF noise by changing the paradigm of fixed wireless industry. We're setting the new industry standard for RF performance, noise rejection, and overall system scalability. And our hardware comes with the surface-coated bolts. So the black bolts you see on this image are actually having a surface coating that prevents these bolts from getting seized. Yeah, so no more you have to be afraid of seizing the bolts and having to drill the whole bracket down. No, these bolts, which you recognize by the black color, have the surface coating that protects them from seizing. And as much as we care for the RF industry as our main resource, we equally care about the planet. And we're eliminating the use of plastic foam and plastic bags in our product packaging. And we're trying to gradually achieve paper-based packaging on all our products. And all our newest releases are packed in carton packages as the one shown in the picture. One of the most common questions our customers have is where to buy our products. So on our landing page, rfelements.com, you have the stock locator on the top line. Clicking that, it brings you to the page you see, and selecting the product you're looking for and your geographical region, the tool, the stock locator, will show you the list of distributors that that have this product in stock and that are nearest to you. Another very frequent question our customers have: how far our antennas go. So again, on our landing page, you can find on the right side, you can find a tab which says Link Calculator, or Link Calc in short. And this will bring you to this page, where the Link Calculator has a bunch of parameters. You can set the access point, the CPE settings, the frequency, the gains of the antennas, and on. And obviously, of course, you can select our antennas to see what coverage you can actually provide and how far. Also, I would like to invite you to join our virtual community. So the rflab.com is our user forum where, you know, upon registering, you can ask your questions, anything about our products, really, whatever is interested, is in your interest, you can ask us directly there. And I would really recommend it because it's really one of the fastest ways to get the answer to the question you might be having. And on top of that, we also put the recordings of our webinars to this platform. Or you can even search through the questions that were already asked in the past, of course. We also have a large user base using the social media channels. So the Facebook group, RF Elements English, is also a great resource. It's a way you can also actually ask questions and search through the questions and experience of your fellow WISPs. If you check our YouTube channel and type Inside Wireless, or just simply go to that playlist, you'll find quite a few short educational videos on all kinds of topics from the world of RF engineering. So whether you are a seasoned WISP and RF engineer and been in the industry for many years, or maybe if you're just starting, it really doesn't matter whether you need to refresh or really clarify some concept from the world of RF engineering, this is a really great resource. We warmly recommend to use. These videos are very short, typically around 3 to 5 minutes, and really explain the concepts that might be very useful for your daily life as a WISP. And finally, I would like to just mention that the trademarks we mentioned and use in this presentation are solely referencing the compatibility of those third-party products with our antennas. And thank you very much. This has been everything. And thank you for your attention. This is all that we wanted to share with you today. And again, if you have any questions, please stop by and don't hesitate to ask. Thank you and have a great day.